Children may be born into different worlds, but all children deserve the same opportunities in life. A chance to learn, to grow, to build their talents and develop their skills, to realize their potential and find their place in the world. But some children, even in rich countries, get left behind. Learn how the gaps in educational inequality can be closed. Download UNICEF Innocenti's report card, An Unfair Start, which examines educational inequalities for children in rich countries and find out what factors contribute to more inequality. No matter what, all children have the right to a fair start in life.
Indeed, the right to a fair start. Well, this today is about an unfair start. So welcome to UNICEF Innocenti, UNICEF's research center here in historic Florence. It's a center of 600 years of historical care for children, a very special place indeed. Today we are launching this report, Inequality in Children's Education in Rich Countries. It's called An Unfair Start. And it ranks 41 EU and OECD countries on the gaps and equality performance of children in these 41 countries. You might ask, why is it necessary to look at inequalities in rich countries? Inequalities have always existed. It's just how life is and how it always will be, perhaps. But as you saw in the animation video earlier, and as you'll hear from our panelists in the next couple of minutes, it doesn't have to be this way. There is another way. We're going to hear from a group, a dynamic mix of academics, teachers, students, who will explore the findings of the report and interrogate the recommendations, as well as look at some of the good examples and poorer examples that are happening in these 41 countries. But first of all, we have a message from the UN Special Envoy on Global Education, Gordon Brown.
Every single child, every single young person should have the chance to develop their talents, to realize the potential to the full, to bridge the gap between what they are and what they have it in themselves to become. And that means we have to break down all barriers to opportunity. It means we have to remove all the obstacles. And we have not done enough, right across the world, including across Western countries. Despite 200 years of public education, there are still barriers. We still have to open doors. We still have to extend opportunities. And unless we do so, the inequalities which distort our society will continue to destroy the chances of so many young people. It's time to open the doors of opportunity.
Indeed, it's time to open the doors of opportunities to children in Western countries, as Gordon Brown said. And I'm sure our panelists will have a lot to say about what exactly is stopping that. But first, a few welcoming remarks from Priscilla Edele, who is the UNICEF Innocenti Director ad interim, to welcome you here today, and of course all of you online. Please make sure to follow us on this Twitter hashtag is UnfairStart, and we very much welcome your questions online and of course from the audience here today as well. Over to you, Priscilla.
Thank you, Sarah. Distinguished participants, colleagues, students, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Let me start by welcoming everyone who is here in Florence today and those who are watching this online. I would also like to extend my thanks to the following: the Italian government for the 30 years of partnership in supporting our work here on evidence policy and child rights. Gordon Brown for his message that we have just heard, the other panelists and experts who are contributing to this event today in person or on video, the young people who are with us here today, and of course my colleagues who work tirelessly to make sure that we have this wonderful report as well as the event itself. The UNICEF Innocenti report card, An Unfair Start, which we are launching today, highlights major inequalities in children in education in rich countries, despite the 200 years of public education that we have just heard from Gordon Brown. So why does it matter? Why should we be talking about inequalities in education in rich countries? First of all, it's simply unfair, as we've heard, because most of the inequalities are caused by factors beyond children's own individual control. Secondly, can you just imagine how many scientists, innovators, and great thinkers that countries are missing out on if they don't get out of their children the most that we expect? Inequalities, therefore, reduce those skills and talents that we need to solve pressing problems in the world today and for the future. Finally, we also know that inequalities are repeated across generations. The children of today are the parents of tomorrow or the parents of the future. If we tackle inequalities in our children today, we also increase the potential of children in the future. The report card 15 reminds us that rich countries can do more for children at preschool, primary, and secondary school. Starting early with high quality education at preschool is key, and this should continue in primary and secondary education, thus ensuring that all children have a fair start in life and also a chance to realize their full potential. Today, I'm very delighted that we shall be hearing from the voices of young people themselves. We shall also hear those of our experts, as well as teachers and the public in general, as we talk about this most critical issue. So thank you, and we look forward to a rich discussion.
Thank you, Priscilla. So let's turn now to our panel of eminent experts, who are all three co-authors of the report. All three are experts on child well-being and have worked in this field for many years. First of all, we'll have Katharina Zen, who all three are also, of course, social policy experts at UNICEF in Innocenti. So we'll start first with Katharina Zen, who will take us through the league tables, as well as the early years and the impact that inequalities have on children in the preschool years. Then we'll turn to Anna Gramada, who'll be taking us through secondary school, primary school and secondary school, but looking specifically at bullying and reading, the impact of reading inequalities and bullying. Some very surprising findings that you'll hear from the panelists. And then last but not least, we have Gwitha Rees, who'll be looking at the secondary school side, the level of inequalities at secondary school, and also look at some recommendations. So over to you, Kat, to walk us through the league tables first.
Thank you, Sarah. Good morning, everyone. In our report, we acknowledge that differences between children in their education start early, and they certainly do not end at high school graduation. But in our report, we focus specifically on preschool, primary school, and secondary school stages. We also acknowledge that a lot of different things can influence inequalities between children, starting from the country's national context, including things like social policies, going to the specific features of the education system. For instance, do some children have to stay behind and repeat a grade if they're not doing quite as well as their peers? Children's families matter a lot. We look at things like parental occupation and household income. The peers of children, their friends, they can have both positive but also negative influences. And in our report, we do look at things like school level bullying and, of course, the child's own actions. How do we measure inequality between children in education in our report? We have two main measures. The first one is inequalities of outcome. We'll look at reading tests for nearly 40 rich countries. And just to make this very simple, we look at the gap between the reading scores of some of the best performing children and some of the worst performing children. So for example, at the age of 10, even in some of our least unequal countries, we already observe such large gaps that some children are barely able to read the bus schedule, when others are already, you know, reading War and Peace cover to cover and adapting it for the school drama play. We are also looking at the extent to which circumstances outside of children's control, such as, for example, their parents' occupations, may explain variation in children's reading scores. And that's inequalities of opportunities in children's education. So let's jump straight into the league table. This is the top third. And we have three main columns. First, it's preschool, the share of children 1 year before the start of official compulsory schooling who are enrolled in some form of preschool. So this is access rather than inequality necessarily. The second column is the gap between the best and worst performing children in reading in fourth grade, roughly around the age of 10. And the last column, that's a similar performance gap in reading, but at the age of 15. That is the indicator we're using to sort our 40-odd countries, because that suggests that children nearing the end of their compulsory schooling, and some of them are having an unfair start of their adult lives. The country at the very top is Latvia, and there are only three countries, Latvia, Portugal, and Finland, that are doing consistently well in all three stages of schooling. In the middle, we have some of the world's richest economies, such as the United States and the United Kingdom, that you might think could certainly do better than sit in the very middle of the league table, a rather mediocre placing. But in fact, there is no relationship whatsoever between country national wealth and any of the ranks in this league table. Then at the bottom, we have countries like Bulgaria, Malta, Israel, but also New Zealand and Australia that are the most unequal countries in our comparison. Countries with larger performance gaps between children at age 15 tend to have fewer children achieving basic literacy, and that is at age 15. So you would really rather be in the top left-hand corner where countries like Ireland are, the ones with high standards but also low inequality. So there is no necessary trade-off between high standards and equality in children's education. Now, on preschool, I will only highlight one single thing, and that is for 29 European countries, we have data on household income and children's access to early years education and care. And we find that in over half of these countries, children from the richest households are a lot more likely to be attending center-based early childhood education and care. So that is very much an unequal start. And this is preschool children aged 3 and over. And now over to Anna on primary school.
Thank you, Kat. Imagine that your country were a class of 30 students. Then we ignore the top 10% and the bottom 10%, which means the three top performing ones and the bottom three performing ones. And even if we focus on this limited range, this 80% in the middle, the gaps are still huge in all of the 31 analyzed systems. Let's look at the three most equal and the three most unequal. The smallest gaps are seen in the Netherlands, with one Netherlands, Flanders, and Latvia. The biggest ones in Israel, New Zealand, and Malta. They range from 150 to 232 points. What does it mean? What do all these points mean? There are four proficiency benchmarks, from basic to the advanced. At the basic benchmark, a child is not even able to locate information which is explicitly stated in the text. This means that when a child is confronted with the sentence, "The man first landed on the moon in 1969, then such a child cannot tackle the question, what was the year when the man first put his foot on the moon. By contrast, at the other end of the spectrum, we have an advanced benchmark. When a child is already able to interpret hidden motives of complex literary characters, by asking questions, for example, what did Romeo feel but didn't really say? What did Julia say but didn't really feel?
And the difference between all these benchmarks is 225 points, which means that Israel, New Zealand, and Malta have the bigger gaps than the whole spectrum of proficiency levels. However, the most equal countries, for example, the Netherlands or Latvia, shouldn't be that happy either, because even the smallest gaps, that of 150 points, is still equivalent to two proficiency benchmarks. Obviously, there is a question, what stands behind these gaps? Usually, the most classic explanation is, what do your parents do? It is true. In all of the analyzed countries, it is enough to have one parent in a professional job to do significantly better. These kids do better by 20 to 60 points according to the country. However, parental job is not the end of the story. We also look at such factors as parental education, gender, language that you speak, the country of origin, school location, or whether a child shows up to school hungry or tired. All these eight factors taken together explain up to 42% of the reading gaps. This ranges from 7% in Portugal to 42% in Slovakia. And as you can see, parental occupation still is the single most important factor. However, it is not the end of the story. All these factors are circumstances beyond children's control, but at the individual level. There is also a story of school differences. Those of you who lived in cities when the rich and the poor tend to live separately will know what I mean. Let's look at the three most divided and three least divided countries. The smallest gaps are in Slovenia, Finland, and Norway, the biggest ones in New Zealand, Israel, and Bulgaria. This means that if you are picking a school for your 10-year-old, for example, in Slovenia, the choice between two alternatives would look something like this. The school would, on average, make only 4% of a difference. However, if you send your 10-year-old to a school in Bulgaria, the choice between two alternative schools will make a huge difference and explain up to 40% of reading scores. And all this is already at the age of 10, which is before the children have been segregated or tracked to different academic systems. Now over to Gwitha.
Thank you, Anna. At secondary school, we see that the gaps that Anna has talked about at primary school are even larger. Even in the most equal country, Latvia, the gap between the top and bottom performing students is over 200 points. In Malta and Bulgaria, it's over 300 points. And to put that into context, it's been estimated that a gap of 30 points is equivalent to 1 year of schooling. So these gaps are very large in all countries, and there's lots of room for improvement in every country. We also find at secondary school, as at primary school, that there are, in many countries, there are large differences between schools. In the best, most equal countries, Iceland, Finland, and Norway, school differences explain about 10% of the difference in children's reading scores. But in some countries, such as Bulgaria, Hungary, and the Netherlands, there is more difference between schools than within schools. So that sounds a bit abstract. So to illustrate that, I've picked out two examples similar to the ones that Anna looked at. So here first in Norway, which is a country with relatively low inequality between schools, you can see that the school that the child goes to doesn't make a lot of difference to their chances of doing well at school. But additionally, in this chart, we've highlighted what we've called for simplicity, middle-class and working-class children. So middle-class children are those with parents in professional jobs, working-class children with those in manual jobs. And you can see that in Norway, in addition to there not being much difference between schools, that middle class and working class children are relatively evenly distributed across schools. If we contrast that with Hungary, then we can see a very different picture. First of all, as Anna showed earlier for Bulgaria, there are big differences between the performance of children in different schools. Second, if you look at the colours of the figures in this chart, you can see that in the high-performing school, there are far more middle-class children, and in the lower-performing school, there are far more working-class children. So when you put those two factors together, you realise that this isn't a level playing field. That first of all, children face disadvantages because, or advantages because of their family circumstances. And then in addition, they face advantages or disadvantages depending on the school that they attend. And working class children are less likely to go to a school where children do well than middle class children. So the disadvantages are compounded in many countries. So what can be done? What can countries do to try and reduce the inequalities that this report shows? Well, we can't give a very specific recommendation to any individual country because every country's education system is developed within a broader context. So policies that may work well in one country won't necessarily transfer and work in the same way in another. But in the report, we highlight six types of policies that in general have been shown to increase inequalities within a country. The first of those is early age of selection by ability. So in some countries, children are selected according to ability at the age of 10, 11, or 12, and that determines their educational pathway. And that early selection tends to be associated with higher inequality. Second, tracking. Tracking means when children are allocated to different schools and different pathways. And in some countries, that tracking starts quite early, associated with the selection I've just spoken about. And in those countries, inequality tends to be higher. But in other countries, children are divided within schools rather than between schools, streaming. So while children may attend the same school, they're actually receiving different lessons to their peers within the same school. Fourth factor, in some countries, children regularly repeat a year of schooling. And I think the intention of this is actually to make things more equal, but the evidence is that on average, it tends to make things less equal. The fifth factor is school types. Some countries have a number of types of schools, public, private, and so on. And again, that's associated, on average, with greater inequality. And finally, school choice. So in some countries, rather than a child going to the local school, parents have a choice about which school a child will attend. And again, this has been associated with greater inequality. So these are some of the policies that countries can consider if they wish to reduce the level of inequality that we've highlighted.
Thank you very much to all three of you. So you've all three of you have mentioned things that children can't really do much about. It's where they live, where their parents are from, what occupation their parents have. But nonetheless, governments, of course, are accountable for delivering for their students, for equality. So what would you say would be the three things that governments can do, starting with you, Gwitha, to try and lessen that gap, to try and close those gaps?
Well, I think the first thing is, a final slide we have, is to pay attention to equality as well as standards. So I think when these international studies are published at the moment, that governments look at where they stand in a kind of league table of the average child. And of course, that's important. That's one useful measure. But what we're trying to encourage in this report is a two-dimensional approach so that not only do countries think about how the average child is doing, but how much inequality there is between children. And there's an excellent example here of Italy and France. They have pretty much the same average educational standards. But Italy is does a lot better than average for equality between children, whereas France is one of the most unequal countries. So standards and equality do tend to go together, but it's still important to look at both of those aspects when you're judging the performance of an educational system.
And Anna, what would you like to add with particular consideration for primary? What recommendations would you focus on?
Watch out at what age you start to segregate kids, especially, firstly, when you do this, when they are too young to show their potential. Secondly, when you tell these kids who are too young to show their potential that you sorted them by ability, so they are perfectly aware why they are tracked to a different system. And thirdly, when you don't even have clear criteria for this segregation, apart from some vague recommendations that are especially likely to be influenced by well-educated parents.
Right, thank you, Anna. And Kat, what would you say in summary for the audience, and also just obviously looking at preschool, but in general on the league tables, what do you think are the key areas of recommendation for governments?
Well, I think early years education is one of the key areas where all of the rich countries' governments could do more. We now have all this evidence about the importance of the children's earliest years for their development and growth, and yet most of the education spending is going to university education. That's pretty expensive, and very few children, relatively speaking, end up there. So we could focus more on guaranteeing high quality early years education and care so that all children could access it irrespective of their families' incomes. And we have some very good examples in this report. For instance, Denmark. It's a country where not only nearly all the children 1 year before they start school access preschool education, but also nearly all children between the ages of 3 and the age of compulsory schooling, and also 70% of under 3s go to some form of center-based care, and that is the highest rate in Europe and in our analysis in general. And of course you might say, hey, look at the league table, the preschool ranks have nothing to do with the secondary school ranks, so maybe preschool access doesn't guarantee anything. And no, it's not a silver bullet. First of all, these are all different cohorts of children measured in 2015, 2016, rather than the same children followed over time. And we certainly need more cross-country comparative data that do follow the same children over time. But the thing is, preschool education will not solve all your problems. It is a necessary, if not a sufficient condition, but we certainly need to start investing more into the children's earliest years.
Thank you very much to all three panelists, and of course to Priscilla Adele, the director of UNICEF Innocenti. Before you all move, we're going to hear now from the global view from Professor Jane Wald-Vogel, who's from Columbia University and also visiting professor at the London School of Economics. And she will give us a non-UNICEF perspective, if we can say that. So let's listen to Professor Jane Wald-Vogel. Thank you.
I'm really pleased to be able to have the opportunity to comment on this wonderful new report by researchers at UNICEF's Innocenti Research Center. The report tackles a very important topic, educational inequalities in rich countries, using recent data from across 41 high and middle income countries to produce some very important findings. Let me highlight three. First, the report finds that there's a lot of educational inequality in rich countries, but that the amount of that inequality varies considerably by country. This is critical for policymakers because it means that a high level of inequality is not inevitable, but in fact can be reduced through policy efforts. Countries can and should learn from each other about how they can do better to give all children a better start in life. Second, the report also sheds some light on some of the major sources of inequality. Not surprisingly, the report provides consistent evidence that children from families of lower socioeconomic status tend to fall behind their peers from more advantaged families. But again, the good news here is that these kinds of gaps are not inevitable. Some countries have SES gaps that are considerably smaller or even non-existent than other countries. And importantly, you can have high achievement and high equality. The two really can go hand in hand. So again, this suggests that countries can and should be learning from each other. Third, the report sheds light on the role of schools, very important in this domain. The role of schools both in producing inequality and in helping to reduce it. Now, obviously, identifying the role of specific policies is complex. There's no doubt that schools can and should make a difference. It's also clear that there are some policies that are helpful and some that are less helpful. School-level policies like tracking can amplify inequality, while a focus on making sure that every child is able to learn to a good level can reduce inequality. So here again, the message is countries can and should learn from each other. Now, I'm speaking to you from here in the United States, which tends to have high levels of inequality. So for us here in the United States, these messages are particularly crucial. But wherever you are, I encourage you to read the report and learn how your country could do more to meet the goal that I'm sure we all share, which is making sure that all of our children have the best possible chance to learn. Thank you very much, and all the best with this wonderful report.
Before we go to the next video, we're going to hear first from our panelists to continue the view from the outside, let's say, to see what can be done, what lessons have you, can you bring forward, what lessons can be learnt from examples around the world. So first of all, we have Alyssa Goodman, Professor of Economics and Director of the Centre for Longitudinal Studies at the University of London, University College London. And you're going to be talking about the long-term consequences on inequalities for children. Then we have Kitty Stewart, Associate Professor, heading up the Centre for Analysis of Social Exclusion, or CASE. And you'll be talking, Kitty, about accessing early education. And then finally, we'll have Jan van der Mottelen, who'll be an eminent United Nations, what can I say, roaming ambassador in a sense, 30-odd years in different places in the world, and now an independent researcher and lecturer. First over to you, Alyssa.
Thanks very much, and thank you so much for inviting me to Florence. This report is hugely important for many reasons, and I want to talk about the long-term value of education and the long-lasting effects, not just across one lifetime, but potentially across many generations that educational inequalities like these can have. So I think we all recognize very intuitively what a formative time our schooling years are. You recognize that whether you're a young person now at school, so my daughter Hannah here in the hat, who's joined me today at school, and we recognize it across our whole lives that even when our schooling years are many years behind us, we feel intuitively what an important time it is. And while things like how well we learn to read, or our maths, and the indices and measures that we've been able to compare in this report are fundamental, I think we all recognize that it's about the wider package of learning and education that we get while we're at school that's important. So as well as the fundamentals of our cognitive development, it's about the friends that we meet and our peers. It's about the way that we are supported in our social and emotional challenges. It's about our creativity and how we rise to challenges. So I think we all understand the importance of education in a very broad sense. And of course, if we could have measured inequalities in those broader things, as well as the educational indices across countries, I think we would find that they would be at least as unequal, possibly more, than things like the reading and writing, the basic and the access measures that we do measure in this report today. So we recognize intuitively what a formative time and how important education is. Research from the studies that I run in London, which follow people from the earliest stages of their childhood and through into adult life across the whole of their lives and now up until older age, support and back this up loud and clear. So, of course, education is important for the knowledge that we gain, for the potential that it gives us for getting a job and earning and the employment opportunities that come from education, but it turns out not just from our intuition, but from robust research from around the world, that it's hugely important for many more things than that. So we can see that the quality of education, the amount of education that you have access to is important for things like your partnerships, for your participation in society, whether you vote, your support of democracy. It matters for how we go on to parent our own children. And it matters also for our health, even going into older ages, for how long we live. So it's clear that education is important on this individual level. But I think what's at the heart of this report, what we can really take away from this, is how important it is for society as well. So educational inequalities are at the fundamental root of why some economies and societies are so much more unequal than others, why there's such a huge gaps between the rich and the poor and different developed nations, and also why there are gaps that persist across generations. So why is it that poverty and deprivation can be so long-lasting and persisting from one generation to the next, and why there are cycles of affluence and well-being also that persist across generations? The educational experience in childhood is at the root of all of those. So it's the long-term feature of these inequalities that we track across countries that matters so much, and why rising to the challenge of finding the right interventions to tackle those is such an important challenge for all the countries who have been surveyed in this report. Thank you.
Over to you, Kitty.
Thank you very much for having me here. I'd also like to begin by congratulating the authors on a really useful and important report. A crucial report, first, because as Alyssa has highlighted, educational inequalities really matter as education shapes the possibilities that are open to children for the rest of their lives. So if we care about inequality at all, we have to make sure that children have an equal start. And the report's also important, as I think Jane highlighted, because these international comparisons show us that inequalities don't need to be as large as they are in many of the countries that we're looking at. They're not inevitable, certainly not on the scale that we see, and policy can really make a difference. So with a focus on the preschool and primary years, I'd like to highlight three key areas for policy focus. The first is the quality of early education and childcare provision. And our quality is not covered in the report, which focuses in relation to preschool on the numbers enrolled. And that's because, of course, comparable, reliable data on quality is really hard to come by. But as the report highlights, what gets measured is what gets done. And it can be tempting for policymakers to focus on expanding the number of places available without paying enough attention to the quality of those places. And we know that quality really matters. So not all centre-based care just in itself is positive for children's development. To make it different, it has to provide an environment that's warm, that's safe, that's responsive, and that's stimulating. And there are several features that we know are really important to that. One of them is the qualifications of staff is really crucial. Also, the ratios of staff to children and the quality of physical space are also relevant. In practice, we know children's experience of early education, what they experience day to day when they attend, is very different, not just across countries, but within countries too. So, for example, in England, some three-year-olds attend a nursery class headed by a qualified teacher who's a graduate with a teaching qualification on top of that. Other three-year-olds attend a setting where they will be cared for by 16 or 17-year-olds, recently left school, very few or no qualifications, who made a decision, you know, a difficult decision between childcare and hairdressing as an occupation. It's actually an odd but positive feature of the English system that I just wanted to highlight, that in fact, in our country, the children from the more disadvantaged backgrounds are more likely to get access to the teacher. That's just a historical accident because the settings with the teachers happen to be, they were developed in the inner city areas where more disadvantaged children tend to live. In general, though, without very deliberate policy effort, inequalities in the quality of provision tend to reinforce disadvantage rather than to even things up. So countries really need to be paying attention to the quality overall, but they also need to be really carefully thinking about the way that regulation and funding mechanisms work using those levers to make sure that the children who have most to gain from early education can really access the highest quality provision available. The second thing I wanted to highlight is to think a bit about services for children, young children whose parents are not working. Because one thing I noticed looking at the report is that the differences in exposure to centre-based care that we see reflect, particularly for under threes, reflect what I know about differences in maternal labour force participation across countries. So that's what we'd expect, and the causation there you can see would run both ways. So mothers who work are more likely to make use of childcare and send their children to a childcare setting. And if childcare is available and it's affordable, then it makes it easier for mothers to work. So the relationship runs both ways. And one conclusion is that it's what we might call a double dividend. So if you invest in making childcare more accessible, you also have the benefit of enabling parents to work. But I also want us to remember that early education doesn't only take place in childcare settings. So services can actually offer families play and learning activities from birth onwards, even where parents aren't working. So parents and carers can attend those kinds of activities together with their children. So I'm thinking of something like the Sure Start Children's Centre model that we have in England. At its best, this kind of provision can really engage the very most marginalised families from very early on and make it more likely that those families are more likely to take up more formal early education when the time's right, at, say, at age three. Third, and finally, I'd like to emphasise a theme that runs right through the report, which is that family circumstances themselves are really hugely influential in determining educational attainment, and we can't ignore those. There's really strong evidence from research that income itself makes a difference to children's educational attainment. In part, that's because of the things that money can buy. Books, computers, healthy, nutritious food, trips to museums and holidays in places like Florence, which can be hugely stimulating and open horizons. It's also, though, because living on a low income is really stressful, and it's much harder for parents to concentrate on children's progress, to listen to what their school day was like, to help them with their homework if they are worried about making ends meet and how they're going to reach the end of the week. So I think the report is really rightly draws attention to differences in access to education and to inequalities in the schooling system, but it's also right to note in its conclusions that schools can't do everything on their own. Disparities in attainment reflect not only education policy, but they also reflect wider social policy. So if we are to reduce education inequality, we really have to have a strategy for reducing child poverty as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Kitty. Jon, Kitty mentioned the double dividend. Do you think governments are seeing this, are harnessing this opportunity, or do they rather tend to think of creating centres of excellence which are fundamentally unequal in the greater scheme of things?
Some are, some are not. This is, of course, a highly political debate. And I think the value of this report is to bring that debate to the country level, which remains a political debate, but which will hopefully help in several countries to have a serene debate based on the evidence. And the report card clearly shows that the most important words in any educational system everywhere is equity or less inequality. And it's not the first item that comes to the mind for most people. Most people think about performance when they talk about educational performance. And this report, its value lies in connecting the two and clearly showing that the trade-off between performance and equality is an illusion.
So what's to be done?
What's to be done, as has been shown before, those six policy areas that were nicely presented on the diagram, have a debate at the country level about whether repetition is really helping the overall performance. We know it doesn't help equality. Whether early tracking is a good thing, because we see that when we do early tracking, that it's mostly children from most disadvantaged backgrounds that end up in the lower tracks. And that's not good, because the talents and the abilities in that group of students is as high as in the other groups, but somehow they get distorted.
Kitty, what about the general historical perspective? Are we seeing over a period of the last generation some improvements, or are we seeing a dangerous slip back to these sorts of more pockets of excellence, if you like, and creating bigger gaps between the rich and the poor?
I think we've got to remember that there's been huge progress. Certainly, you know, if we look back in my own country, in the UK, it's only, you know, 60, 70 years ago that we've had a national education service that made sure that everybody could attend. And we've also, I think, seen progress in, I think governments have been thinking about this and how to reach all children and how to make sure that provision is more equally accessible. But I think progress in many places is very slow. And there are times when we see things getting worse rather than better. I highlighted the importance of child poverty as well, so the kind of wider social context. And again, we see rates of child poverty across European countries that are still too high and very persistent. So I think there's certainly not fast enough progress.
And your thoughts, Alyssa, bearing in mind that Gordon Brown speaks about 200 years of public education and still there isn't the progress that you'd expect in the 21st century.
Absolutely. I think this is a problem. This is a thorny problem. And we should be optimistic that governments are increasingly focused on inequality and doing something about it. There's obviously an awful long way to go. And I think we've sort of listened to the idea that there's a lot about this that's outside of the school's control. So about family income and family background and systemic inequalities in our society that are perpetuated. I think if there's one place where we could intervene and empower schools, it's really about supporting the excellence of teaching and school leadership and the whole school ethos.
Thank you very much. Clearly this is a huge issue. We just had an OECD report out looking at other ways to promote equity in education and to stop these gaps, to try and bridge the gaps. We'll hear now from Yuri Belfali, who is the head of the PISA unit at OECD, to talk a little bit about their findings and how they amplify the findings of UNICEF report, An Unfair Start.
Good morning. I am Yuri Belfali, and I am the head of the OECD unit responsible for the Program for International Student Assessment, PISA, as well as research and policy advice in the area of early childhood education and schooling. It is an honor to speak at the launch event for the 15th Innocenti Report Card, An Unfair Starting Inequality in Children's Education in Rich Countries. At the OECD, we believe that equity is a fundamental value and guiding principle of policy and practice across all levels of education. However, it remains an unfulfilled goal in many schools and education systems around the world. This is why it is so fundamental that we continue building the evidence base needed to support reforms that promote equity in education and through education. The work contained in the report card inspired me a lot. Many of those who read this will go straight to the league table results, but I found the rich analysis particularly valuable. The report card helps us think how we could make a change so that socioeconomic status makes less of a difference in students' learning, well-being, and post-secondary educational attainment. We need all the insights we can get if we are to meet the SDG goals and targets. I'm also pleased to see that many of the lessons the OECD has learned from our recent reports were taken up in the report card, such as the resilience of students with an immigrant background, factors that shape well-being, and that the OECD is helping to answer to the call made for more comparative longitudinal evidence. In fact, our newly released PISA thematic report, Equity in Education, Breaking Down Barriers to Social Mobility, shows that disparities in academic performance related to socioeconomic status develop early and widen throughout students' lives. Longitudinal data for individual students in Australia, Canada, Denmark, Switzerland, and the United States suggest that 15-year-old students who score in the top quarter in reading are between 38 and 53 percentage points more likely to complete university than students who scored in the bottom quarter, and that students with at least one tertiary educated parent are between 17 and 30 percentage points more likely to complete university than their peers without tertiary educated parents. Crucially, we find that the differences in 15-year-olds' reading performance explain between 27 and 43% of the difference in university completion rates between advantaged and disadvantaged students. This suggests that reducing socioeconomic differences in what students learn during compulsory schooling could increase educational mobility and, through it, the life chances of youngsters. Before I conclude, let me stress how important it is to build dialogue and connections among all of us who have the issue of educational equity in our hearts. I thank UNICEF Innocenti for the opportunity to include the OECD's perspective in this crucial policy discussion, and I would like to highlight that the OECD is starting new work to explore the issue of equity in education in greater depth. The report card released today will be a key resource for us, and I hope that my participation in this launch event will lead to opportunities for intense collaboration in the future.
And OECD, of course, is a great resource of data, and particularly the PISA data, on which some of this report is based, including a number of different sources. Of course, data is the foundation of knowledge and evidence, and that's what, of course, UNICEF Innocenti aims to do at the research center here. So let's have a look at a data infograph, kind of simplifies and condenses what the data is all about.
By age 15, children should have the knowledge and skills they need to make their way in the world. But too often, they don't get the chance to perform and achieve. Even in rich countries, there are large gaps between the best and worst performing students. Educational inequality occurs everywhere. UNICEF Innocenti's Report Card 15, An Unfair Start. Inequality in Children's Education in Rich Countries, available now.
Right, of course, as you saw, data is, of course, the foundation. But equally important, or perhaps even more important, is the voices and the thoughts and perspectives of those who are dealing with educational inequalities every single day and know the school systems inside out. And this is, of course, our panelists who are up here before us now. I'm going to ask each four of you, to give your perspectives on how the school systems in particular, may be perpetuating these inequalities. We all know that inequalities exist in society. There's not much that is new there. But is there something that can be done in schools? So we have with us today Minahil Sarfaraz, who's from Ireland, who's been in Ireland since the age of 5, from Pakistan originally, there as a refugee. Then we have Fanula Makanisa, who's worked with the traveler student community in Ireland for many, many years. And we have Gian Mario Consentino, who's from Northern Italy and a UNICEF volunteer and a student himself. And then we have Marco Rossi Doria, who is a teacher and also advisor, undersecretary in education for the Italian government. I'm going to start first of all with you, Minahil. If you could give us a sense of, if you were the Minister of Education, What would you do? How would you change the system? And let us have a few of your thoughts on your experiences in Ireland of education inequalities.
Well, I would like to start by saying that the most powerful thing that we can do, or if I were the minister, that I would do, would be to heighten the expectations we have on children. I feel like a lot of the time, the kids who have higher expectations do better in school than ones who have lower expectations. I know personally that since I came here as an immigrant or a refugee, I knew I had to do better than others. I knew I had to work harder than others in order to achieve what I want to achieve and in order to be successful. And my peers who are also immigrants, they also know that they also do well, they also work harder, and that has helped us learn the value of education and learn how far we have to go in order to do well in school. So definitely, in order to increase the percentage of children that are doing better in school, you have to ask them to do better. You have to expect them to do better, and then they'll try to do better. One thing I really want to say is that a lot of times parents feel that they don't have to tell their children to do well. They feel like they have no say in it. They say, oh, you go to school, that's it. But in order to encourage a child, you as a parent have to tell your child, look, you have to work hard, you have to do things in order to achieve things. And no matter how hard it might be, you still have to work. I know if my mom didn't expect things of me, I would probably not go to school. I probably wouldn't be here today. It's only because of my mother that I say, look, I have to do well for her and for myself. I remember I used to always be good at maths. That was my favorite subject. I flied at it. But there was a time in my life where that wasn't happening anymore. I was like, okay, this is not normal. I'm not good at it anymore, and I just gave up. I was like, well, now this is just not your thing. Just leave it. But if it weren't for my teacher, who noticed me, she's like, no, stay back for a second. I was like, okay, what did I do wrong? She's like, you lost your confidence and you have to get it back. So she told me to go to a smaller classroom so that I would feel on top again. And then I came back and I was achieving the same results I was before in math, if not better. So I want also to say that teachers often forget their importance as well. Sometimes they're like, oh, the students don't love us, but I respect my teachers greatly. If it weren't for her, my math teacher, I would have given up of school as well. So teachers, I feel like you should just value your importance as well. Parents, you should value importance, and students, you should value your importance.
Value importance, but of course you also had tremendous amount of help from on the home front from your mother, as you mentioned. But what about those who don't? Fionnuala, with the travelling community, it's a very different story, is it not? And what can governments do for those kinds of communities, whether it's the Roma community or the traveller community in Ireland? What is being done and what should be done?
Well, I think before we do anything, it's really about looking, listening and learning. You know, by pure coincidence, Minahel, I attended, I'm a past pupil of the school that Minahel is currently attending, and it really led me to reflect on some of the advantages that I would have experienced, and frankly, the unfair start that I, and I suspect most of the people in this room had. You know, you don't need to sell the transformational power and potential of education to anybody who's experienced it firsthand, who's seen it with their own eyes. But the most marginalized communities have not seen that transformational potential or power. In actual fact, they have seen education, their own experience of education has been that it has replicated and magnified and amplified the inequalities that they are already experiencing. So where you have children coming from families of, you know, first, second, third generation, where their experiences within the educational system were broadly speaking negative and were broadly speaking very challenging, where the kind of expectation that Minahel was talking about was not placed on them, where the inevitability of them not succeeding within the education system was accepted and taken for granted, that it's very hard to actually sell the power of education and the importance of education to those families. And it's particularly hard to sell it if we are not doing it as a partnership, if we're not saying, let's start as a partnership, let's start as a team, let's start as a shared and joint enterprise and look at how we work together to address some of the inequalities that our children in the most marginalized groups are experiencing.
So I'll turn now to Gian Mario and just encourage those who do not speak Italian in the room. You have headphones on you. The panelists can also hear, and I'm sure, Gian Mario, your English is probably a lot better than you're admitting. But give us a sense from your perspective in Northern Italy. What have you experienced? What have you seen in your everyday life as a student?
Ecco, sì, sicuramente parlando di disuguaglianze, quindi nel ricercare elementi e fattori per poterla appunto eliminare e
find policies to eliminate inequalities, I would mention, I think, one of the most important factors that would help us solve this problem, which is we've got to eliminate economic barriers. In our modern society, the modern society we live in, it's inconceivable, I think, that so many of my peers and my fellow students have to go to work the minute compulsory schooling years are over and they have to go and find a job. And they're not able to get a complete education the way the rest of us can. The other important element, I think it's very important to focus on the curricula and which would see the participation of students and encourage their participation. When I say participation, I mean stimulate the will to work, to study, and a better relationship between students and teachers, and wanting to build your future.
Marco Rossi Doria, you could pick up some of that because, of course, you have very specific experience from Italy. And not to pick on Italy in particular, but, of course, we are here today in Florence, and the government of Italy has been very generous over the past 30 years to UNICEF Innocenti. So what have you seen in your experience? And perhaps also just a little bit about migrants, because, of course, that is another key area. We've seen in the report that migration background is one of the reasons why there is inequality in people's, in children's experiences as well.
Yes, first of all, the six recommendations we have in this report are very, very important. And this is true in the Italian case as well. We can see that where there is a weaker early education, for instance, large parts of southern Italy and peripheries in the city of Rome or elsewhere, we have major problems with dropouts and weaker literacy and basic numeracy skills, etc. So those recommendations are very, very important. I would also wish to stress on the basis of a quite long experience as a teacher in primary school, then as a street teacher with adolescents that were dropouts in poor districts in the city of Naples, which has a very high ratio of dropping out, around 22-23%, which is very, very high. The average in Italy is around 13% at the moment, which is also high, but it's the average. That it is very important also to give second opportunities, second chances. It's very important to not consider school as a standard offer equal for all. You have to give more to people that have less, and that start with less. And this means not only a different school with an approach. Italy is actually quite inclusive. All the data we have shows this, and this is very important for us, naturally. But at the same time, we have a hard time in differentiating our educational offer in order to reach out, actually, towards all. And then another key issue, I think, not only for Italy, is that policy building in education in poor areas is not only within schools. It's the whole neighborhood that must be activized. There must be a strong alliance with NGOs, with the private sector, with sports, with everything that reaches out to children. And the financing must be constant in time. We have a huge amount of good practices in Italy, but they fade away because of the complexity of bureaucracy and of financing that comes, goes away, comes back. There must be at least 20-year-long policies in poor districts, which means, it's already been said, fighting against poverty, but also fighting for community, people-centered and place-centered activities for long periods of time, 20 years. This, whenever this has happened, and sometimes it has happened in Italy as well, we have really impressive progress.
So if we take up, we've had, while you're talking, a number of questions from online, and I will encourage those who are online. This is our hashtag, Unfair Start. So please continue to send your questions and your thoughts as we're going out live. Maybe I'll turn now to Anna, because I think one of the areas that seems to come up is the findings on migration, and we didn't go into it that much earlier, and particularly picking up the two points from Minahil and also from Marco Rossidorio. So Anna, what would you say, and then maybe Jan, I'd like to hear from your experiences too, more broadly. Anna, can you just kind of tease through the migration findings and what you found from the report.
We found that in almost all analyzed systems, first generation migrants are doing significantly worse than the children who are born in the country where they go to school. However, what is interesting is that when we focus on second generation migrants, they are doing worse only in half of the analyzed systems, while in the other half, there is no difference between them and the children who are born in the country where they go to school. This raises a question of what makes the difference between these countries that can successfully integrate their students, at least at the level of second-generation migrants, from those who don't. At the same time, we have to draw the attention that some countries pick their migrants in a specific way. For example, Anglo-Saxon countries such as Australia or New Zealand. When you have a pre-selection of migrants, then there's no wonder that then their children are doing better. That's why we should... There is a complexity to interpretation of this data, because the fact that the migrants are doing not as good as local children might reflect migration policies of the country, not necessarily the school system.
Thank you, and it seems to amplify your points there. Jan, any thoughts from what you've experienced in your 30-odd years with the United Nations?
Migrants, of course, migrant children are at a disadvantage because of the language, but children learn quickly, and as Minahil emphasized, migrant population tend to take more responsibility when it comes to the students and to the parents within their limited capacity. They are at a disadvantage, but what we see everywhere in the world is that minorities and migrant children are more serious about taking the opportunities. The question is, are the opportunities a level playing field or not? And in most of our countries, they are not, and they are even become less level as they were before.
Thank you, Jan. And any questions in the audience here today, please put up your hands. But I'll just go back here now to our panelists. So from your experiences, again, you've been quite lucky in some ways, haven't you? What about those who are not so lucky, about, you know, the Roma children, the traveler community that Fionnuala mentioned, the migrants who have come in to Europe over the past 3-4 years? And as Jan said, of course, they've got, you had English to a certain extent growing up in Ireland at the age of 5. Not all of them do, and they're coming from very many different school systems. So what would your advice be to schools and to migrant communities as well, Minail?
I think it's all about making the migrants feel like they belong at a very young age. I mean, I came at the age of 5, and you're right, I was lucky in that way because I learned English really quickly, but I still felt a bit of that hate coming towards me, like people didn't want me there, and that really affected me even as I grew up. But for someone who's coming like at the age of 16 maybe, that is immensely hard, really difficult. I mean, you have to take in a new culture, a new language, a new school system, a new way of living. That's crazy amount. So you really have to focus on bringing people in, like knowing that it's going to be different and it's going to be difficult, but you have to keep working and you have to, you know, stay focused. And also for the people who are already in the country to help welcome the new citizens or new people that are coming to their country. Also, I think it's really important to have workshops and different material for schools to help integrate different migrants into their societies. Like my friend Natasha and I, we created different workshops and resources for schools to aid schools in this mission. Really, it's all about making people feel like they belong and helping people understand that this country is also your home.
And in the traveler community, do they feel at home even though they are in their own country? Does that affect them the same way?
I suppose the short answer is unfortunately in many cases no. Young traveler people once said to me, when I arrive at the school gate, I have to leave my identity at the gate. And I think that there's a real tragedy in that. So if pupils are going to school and they're not seeing themselves recognised, valued, you know, members of the community and members of the society. But I think that Marco's point about building a sort of a community response is really important. I think that it is about looking to take kind of community-wide, parental, the child's own actions and the school taking actually a role in terms of generating high levels of expectation, a good sense of inclusion, and also that inclusion actually isn't about integration or assimilation, which too often it has been for those populations like Roma children and like traveller peoples.
Right, thank you. I'm going to turn now to you, Kat. We had a question online, not so much related to migration, but related to international comparisons. And do they underestimate inequality? Is anyone left out? For example, there's a mic there for you right there, so I don't need to give it to you. For example, the Nordic community was a case in point that was brought up online that they have gone down in recent years. Is that related to migration at all?
Yes, thank you. Obviously, everything we have in our report is somewhat of a lower bound on the extent of inequality in children's education in rich countries. And yes, indeed, partly it's because there are some children who are absent from school on the day of this international tests, such as, for example, PISA at age 15. In fact, we had to exclude three countries from our ranking, Chile, Turkey, and Mexico, because the PISA coverage of the 15-year-old population was not good enough for us to include them in the comparison. There are also children who are starting to take the test. They're at school on the PISA day. They started taking the test, but they didn't finish it. And so they're not in our rankings. And of course, if they were included, they would have scored very poorly because they have not actually finished the test. Now, the immigration question, indeed, we were quite careful with that. We have reanalyzed all our data with and without children with a migration background. And indeed, in just very, very few countries, there was a very small but noticeable difference in the rankings. So, for example, in Sweden, you might say that if we excluded all children with an immigrant background, Sweden would have ranked somewhat higher in the league table. But that's a very artificial comparison. And I wouldn't encourage anyone to exclude a whole subgroup that you might expect to do somewhat worse in order to do better in international league tables. Thank you.
Thank you, Kat. I think we had a question from the audience over here. Yes, please.
Hi. This is a question for the team of authors. Going back to the importance of stress and inclusion and, you know, also emotions at school and how we live through school, you mentioned before the results about bullying, but then we never saw them. So I was wondering if you could say something, Guido or Anna, if you can say something about that.
Thank you for that question. Yes, good point on bullying and the link to reading. That was an interesting finding as well in the report. And please, to our panelists, particularly Gian Mario and Menahil, if you've come across cases of bullying and you've seen how that's impacted on those inequalities and held children back, please intervene after we hear from Anna.
We show that it's not just big factors like what do your parents do. What children do at school also influences reading scores. And the most important result is that bullying affects everybody, not just the victims. This is an important lesson also for us, for adults, because sometimes we stand behind and think, no, it's not about me, it is not true, it is about you. With bullying and school, we show that even if we control for all eight factors that I showed you that are known to influence reading scores, those schools where there is bullying score significantly worse. For example, let's take the US. In the US, around one in two children, around half of the kids, are bullied at least monthly, including 15% that are bullied at least weekly. For each percentage point of this 15%, the school average reading score drops for 1.13, which means that this school that has, for example, 15 percentage points of kids bullied weekly has 17 points lower score when compared to the school of the same social economic background with very little bullying. And this is effect on everybody. Bullying creates an atmosphere of fear, which is not conducive to learning, and it is about all of us, not just the victims.
That's really an astonishing figure. From your perspective in Italy and indeed in Ireland, have you come across similar cases and what to be done about it?
The thing about bullying is, sometimes it's so hard to see where it is. It's very hard to identify bullying and see, look, this child's getting bullied. But in my own experience, I remember when I was in primary school, just because of my religion and my status in society, I was bullied greatly. But, you know, like, it's the sad fact of it is that people just accept it. You know, bullying, it's always going to happen, and no one really wants to do anything about it because it's honestly a difficult topic to approach. But the thing about bullying is when you go to school and you want to learn, and there's people there that are preventing you from really focusing on learning, you're not going to learn. The fact that when you go to school, you're supposed to feel at home, you're supposed to feel peaceful, you're supposed to focus on yourself and your future and the world, but you're not supposed to hate yourself or hate someone else. Bullying puts you behind bars, and sometimes you can't identify them. That's why we need to deal with it fast, but the best way to deal with it, belonging, you know, it's always teaching children, especially at a young age, look, you have to accept everybody as who they are, and you cannot downgrade anyone in any way.
And as you say so rightly, it's often behind bars, and particularly when it's online, it's hidden, isn't it? Cyberbullying. Gian Mario, in your experience, how has that impacted on inequalities or just generally on holding children back and not being able to perform and be their best?
Yes,
of course. Bullying is very complex as a phenomenon. I'm lucky. I have never been a victim of bullyism. At least not till now. Not till now. But
I think it really can impact several aspects of one's life. And if you are a victim of bullying, you cannot participate in a normal way to your school career, and you can't do your work properly. And to go back to what I was saying earlier, I think the way to eliminate inequalities is to promote the participation of each and every student in a school so that there are not episodes of bullying at all, ever. That way people
can participate
in school.
So you haven't been a victim yourself, but many others have. And we have a question, I think, on bullying. It's really kind of ignited a lot of interest, doesn't it, from our audience, a young member in the audience. Please tell us your name and your question.
My question is, if you had three separate schools, one within reasonably high expectations and one within reasonably low, and then one with average expectations, how would the mental health and adult lives be different from the children that went to the three separate schools?
Very interesting question. I'm going to turn first to Gwitha and then maybe to Kitty or Alyssa. Thank you, Gwitha.
Thanks. Could the person repeat the question? I didn't quite catch the full meaning of the question.
So if there are three different schools, one with unreasonably high expectations, one with them reasonably low, and then one with average expectations, how would both the mental health and the adult life of the children that went to the three separate schools be different?
Okay, well, at a country level, I think there are some really interesting patterns that the countries that do best educationally, that have the highest standards, are often not the countries that have the highest student well-being. And in fact, some countries that do very well with their average scores are also countries where children are often quite unhappy at school. So certainly, I think it's very important to think about children's well-being as well as how well they're doing at school, and trying to find the right balance between what Minnie Hill was saying about ensuring that children are really encouraged to do well, but also the children don't feel under so much pressure that it makes them really unhappy at school. And certainly there's also evidence that children who are happier as teenagers end up also having better mental health as adults, whereas doing well at school in itself, it isn't a guarantee that you're going to have good mental health as an adult either. So I think it's just a question of balance, really, between, you know, having high expectations but not too much pressure on children to do well.
Thank you, Gwitha. Before we take any more questions, I'd like to turn to our Chief of Social Policy at UNICEF, Innocenti, because we do have a question on why did we rank 39 countries when more than what does the league table rather? What does the league? Why does the league table only rank 39 countries when there are 41 listed? And I think Jose, you'd be well placed to say that. But you also had a comment on the earlier question as well.
So on the question we were asked, is just you know.
Sorry, Jose, if I could ask you to turn around so the audience can see you. Thank you.
On the question asked why we excluded two countries, it's just a question of standards. We want to make sure that all the countries have the same standards to be comparable. So if some countries provide information that doesn't cover a particular amount of the entire population, let's say more than 10% or 15% of the responses, we basically take them out to make sure that you know, we have good information of all the countries for which we have data. So it's a question of basically keeping the standards and comparability. My question is actually not as a researcher, but as a father, because I don't normally think of a school as a place or of a unit to reduce inequality for societies, in the same way that I don't think of a hospital as a place to reduce inequalities. It's a place to where I go when I kneel, or a school I take my children for them to be educated. So I think, you know, the report shows that you know, we can widen inequalities, but also we can reduce inequalities in schools. But I think that also takes a change of mentality and attitude, you know, from parents, from students, from administrators, from governments, from the Ministry of Education, from the Ministry of Finance. So how do we do that change of attitudes? Where do we start? I mean, there are different levels, and it's a responsibility for everyone. But where do we start?
Good question. Yes, where do we start? Why, Marco Rossitorio, why don't you start? Perhaps is it preschool? Or is it before that?
Well, it's giving importance to schools in general. If an educational system goes down in funding schools, like was the case in Italy in recent years. If teachers are asked a lot, for instance, not only teaching math, but giving a good climate, a good atmosphere in the classroom, for instance, being able to contrast bullying or doing the things that Gianmario told us, and yet they're giving less money to the teachers. If teachers aren't trained, if they're not trained along their career, if they don't have time to talk to each other, then that's something very, very important. Very important. If schools are a nice place, if schools have a lot of participatory experiences with the neighborhood, if they are open in the afternoons, if they are open in the evenings, if you go there and learn other things, if people can go there and teach, this makes a school a place that is rigorous because it gives more opportunities, but at the same time, it's curing, it's helpful, it makes you feel not at home, because it shouldn't be a home, but a comfortable place where you can go, a community. It has to be something in between, a very time for very rigorous studying and time for community experience. These schools that learn how to do this actually can put together the two components we're talking about, making your son or daughter feel well at school, and fighting inequality and giving high standards of learning. It's very hard to do, but there's quite a lot of empirical evidence, not maybe of scientific evidence, that if you put all these components together, you have better results across the board.
Thank you very much to you, Marco. So as we wrap up now, and we've had a few questions online, but I think most of them appear to be answered. So I think we'll just start to wind down now and have a last few thoughts. First of all, Finula, you've heard about the inequalities at every level and your own experiences. What would be the takeaway for you, especially if you were to be given the title Minister of Education, if you like?
It really is an answer to that question and an answer to the last one. One of the things, and I think Marco raised it as well, is we're actually really good at starting this. Our country is littered with initiatives and schemes, pilots, policies that weren't followed through on. It's actually a question of sticking with it. It's not about starting it. It's having a middle and an end and staying with it until it's done. That's a hugely important part of it, I think. That would be the big part of it, in the sense. And I suppose the other thing is that I think it has to just be a given. We have to be getting to the point that we were taking it for granted that rich countries that can afford to eliminate soft and hard barriers of poverty to education. Poverty cannot continue to be. There are more complex problems that there are more complex solutions to, but that's a simple one. That is a question of resources in the right place at the right time.
And not just an unfair start, but a fair start, a fair middle, and a fair beginning, and yes. A fair end. Mm. So, final word then to you, Minayo, who've given us so much thought, food for thought. Leave us with some final thoughts.
It's important to note that there's no harm in perfection. I mean, Ireland's doing fairly well, I think, in. Compared to other countries, but you should always try to reach that point of perfection. You know, that's the thing about rights. You should always hope that every single person has those rights and every single person has those opportunities. I feel like countries can sometimes, we're number one, we give up now. No, aim to reach that 100%, always.
Never stop.
Never.
Never give up. Well, thank you very much to all our panelists, to you here in the room, and of course to you online for this very special live event in this beautiful Sala Puccetti room of 600-year-old institution here in the historic heart of Florence, UNICEF Innocenti. We hope that we've given you some sense of solutions, some answers, as you see, for every child answers. That's what they strive to do here. And also, of course, you've seen the obstacles and the barriers, but do know and do take away that there are solutions, that there are recommendations. So stay tuned, please, for our next report card in 2020, I believe it is. And we look forward to having many more live discussions like this. So thank you very much for the thought-provoking panel and to our audience here in the room and to you online.